So let us start our session. So today we are going to discuss about Stephen Boltzmann's law of radiation. So this law states about, you know, if you take a black body, how it radiates energy. Okay. So the law says the rate of emission of radiant energy per unit area or power radiated per unit area of a perfect black body is proportional to the fourth power of absolute temperature. If you say that R is the radiant power, okay, which is emitted per unit area. What is power? Power is energy by time. Okay. Now this power that is emitted from a radiant body, a body which is emitting heat, it is proportional to temperature to the power of 4. Now this temperature is absolute temperature. The temperature should be taken in Kelvin scale. Or R must be equal to some constant into T power 4. This constant we are calling it as Stephen's constant, and its value is 5.67 into 10 power minus 8 joule meter square, second inverse, Kelvin to the power of minus 4. So here are some points you have to understand. What is this R? We have seen yesterday R is Q by AT. Right. So from this you can write that Q by AT is equal to sigma. What is this T and this T? This is temperature and this is time. You take unit time, you take unit area, R becomes equal to Q. So you can write this as Q by AT is equal to sigma T to the power of 4. Now sometimes what happens is you take an object, surrounding there will be a temperature, and this object has been heated up. So let us say the surrounding temperature is TS and this object is heated to a temperature T, such that this T is higher compared with the TS. Then how do you write the same equation? You can write the same equation as R is equal to sigma T to the power of 4 minus TS to the power of 4. Okay, if there is a surrounding temperature, this absolute temperature is the temperature that has been taken after considering the surroundings. Alright, so this is the equation. Then if it is a black body, we write like this. Okay, for in the case of an ordinary body, the same equation becomes R is equal to E multiplied by sigma T to the power of 4. What is this E? E is the emissive power of the body, ordinary body. Okay, E is equal to R divided by RP. If you are using a perfect black body, you should use this expression. If you are using an ordinary body, you should use this expression. You should multiply this with the emissive power. All right. So with this, I have taken care of all the conceptual parts. So now let us look into some numericals. So let us look into some questions. The first question: in an ideal gas, the molecules possess only kinetic energy, both kinetic energy and potential energy, only potential energy, or neither potential energy and kinetic energy. So if you take an ideal gas, first of all, ideal gas don't exist, okay? If you talk about ideal gas consists of all molecules, right? And here the assumption is that this molecule-to-molecule collision is happening, okay? So when the collision rises up, the temperature of the gas also rises up. So here molecule-to-molecule interaction is in the form of only kinetic energy. It doesn't have a potential energy. So this point you should know. And here, this if you take the kinetic energy of the particles, the molecules, it is same. That means if this is molecule A and this is molecule B and this is molecule C, all three will have same kinetic energy. Okay, so option one is the right answer. Let us see the next one. The mean free path of the molecules is given by, now what is mean free path? Suppose you take a glass sample, you have molecules like this. So obviously they are colliding with each other. Alright. So let us say this molecule A is there, this molecule B is there. So it will collide, then that is the first collision. Okay. So then there will be a second collision. Right. So what is this mean free path means? The distance traveled between the successive collisions. Okay, the distance traveled between the successive collisions. So A came and hit B, and then from after hitting B, it hit C. So this distance is there, no? So that distance is mean free path. Now to find out this, suppose you take a sample like this, okay, and we know that we are calling this molecules are spherical in shape, right? So this is the cross section. So this area, I am assuming the area of cross section is circular. So here on this cross section there will be n number of molecules. So when, let us say their velocity is v, okay, and the time gap between two successive collisions is t. The time gap between two successive collisions is t. So vt is the distance traveled between two successive collisions, and that vt is what is your actually the mean free path. So you are using a term called mean. So that means there are lot of molecules are there, so you need to calculate the average of it. So to find the average, what you do is mean free path is denoted by lambda. Okay, so imagine this is the area of cross section. So inside this, let us say vt is the distance traveled. Okay, so the mean free path is defined as lambda. It is equal to, how do you find distance? You find distance, we know that expression that speed is equal to distance by time. Okay, so can we write distance is equal to speed into time? Okay, distance is equal to speed into time. But here the thing is, you don't have one particle, you have n number of molecules are there. So we will divide this by total number, so I will get the mean free path. So here the distance is lambda, so vt divided by, you have to get the total number of molecules here. So the total number of molecules here will be n multiplied by the volume. So what is that volume? Volume is area multiplied by length. So let us say that area, I am assuming this to be a circular cross section. So I will write it as pi d square, this is my area, into the distance. So what is the distance traveled between two successive collisions? It is this. So it is into vt. Okay, so here you see that vt and vt is cancelled, so the mean free path is n into pi into d square. Okay, so option B is the right answer. Option B is the right answer. Actually here this D is the diameter, and I have told you that these molecules we are considering as a spherical surface. So what is the surface area of the sphere? it is 4 pi r square. So pi into 2 r whole square, it is pi d square. Okay, like that it has come. Okay, this pi d square, it is like this. So when you are considering this surface, it is like, you know, it is a surface area of a sphere. So your answer will be, right answer will be option B. So let us move to the next one. The ratio of emissive power of perfect black body at 1327 degrees Celsius and 527 degrees Celsius is. So you have to compare the ratios of emissive power. So if you are comparing the ratios of emissive power, basically you are comparing the ratios of R. So we have seen that R is proportional to T to the power of 4. Okay. So if R, now this T should be, we should be careful, it should be in kelvins. So I can say that R1 by R2 should be equal to T1 to the power of 4 by T to the power of 4. So what is T1? So how to convert this into Kelvin means 1327 plus 273. So 2773 is 100. 13216, it is 1600. And T2 will be, add 273 to this. So 273 means it is, add 27, it is 300. And on top of it, another 500. So this is 800. So this becomes R1 by R2 is equal to 1600 by 800 to the power of 4. So this is 2 times 2 power 4 is 16 by 1. This is what is Stefan's law. So let's move to the next one. If the pressure of ideal gas is decreased by 10% isothermally, then its volume will, okay, the volume will, pressure of the gas, the fourth option is increased by 11%. Okay, small mistake. Now, ideal gas equation, what is that equation? Isothermally. Isothermally means at constant temperature. So you know that at constant temperature, pressure and volumes are inversely related. You decrease the volume, the pressure will increase. That means PV is equal to constant. This is what we know. So here, you can write that P1 V1 is equal to P2 V2. Okay. So we are studying what is volume. So let us say V2 is the final state and V1 is the initial state. So V2 by V1 will be equal to P1 by P2. Okay. So originally the pressure was, let us say, P. And then it was decreased by 10%. So the new P value will be 0.9 P. So this is equal to, originally it was P divided by 0.9 P. So it is like 1 by 0.9 or it is 10 by 9. So 10 by 9 is greater than 1. So it is increasing. So 10 by 9 is 1 by 9. Okay. Or it is 1.11. If you calculate this, you get 1.11. What is the meaning of 1.11? 1.11 is 11% above 100. If you consider this 1 as 100, 1.11 will be 111. Alright. So it is 11% above the original value. So there is an increase, and the increase is by 11.1%. So next question. If the density of oxygen is 1.44 kg per meter cube at a pressure of 10 power 5 newton per meter square, find the root mean square velocity of the oxygen molecules. Now it's like this. For an ideal gas, you know the relationship that PV is equal to nRT. In the question, density is given, which is the rho value. But what is this n value here? N value basically, and we are trying to find out what? We are trying to find out the root mean square velocity of the oxygen. So basically, what is that formula? VRMS is equal to root over 3RT divided by n. This was the formula, right? we are considering one mole. Alright, so here this if you look at this expression, what is this expression? This is PV is equal to, how can I write number of moles? Number of moles will be given mass by molecular weight multiplied by RT. So you take this term here, PMW divided by M by V into RT. What is this M by V? It is rho RT, which is PMW. Alright? So here we have RT. So what is the value of RT here? RT will be equal to PMW by rho. Right? So put this value here. So you get 3 into RT. RT is PMW by rho. And in the denominator already one M is there. So if this M is the MW only. So this and this cancels. So this becomes P, 3P by rho under root. So you need to put the values here. So the value of P is given as 3 into P value is given as 10 power 5 divided by rho value, which is 1 point. All the value should be in SI units, root over. Alright. So if you make the calculation, so you get 456 approximately. 456 meter per second. So that is the answer. So let us move on to the next one. Calculate the energy radiated in 1 minute by a black body of surface area 200 centimeter square at 127 degrees Celsius. So sigma value is given as 5.7 into 10 power minus 8. So we know the expression that R is equal to sigma T to the power of 4. But here what are we trying to find out? This is the radiant power per unit area, per unit time. Okay. So we want energy radiated. So what is R? R is Q by AT is equal to sigma T to the power of 4. So we are here to find out the value of Q. Q is the amount of energy in joules which is emitted. So sigma into A into T to the power of 4. This is time, this is temperature. You can remember this value if it is not given. 5.7 into 10 to the power of minus 8. This is in centimeter square. So 200 into centimeter is 10 power minus 2. It is square. So it is 10 power minus 4. T is 1 minute. We have to convert into seconds. So it is 60 seconds multiplied by T to the power of 4. This is in degree Celsius. We have to convert into Kelvin. All these things I am telling very detailed because unit conversion is very, very important here. So 127 plus 273, it is 400 to the power of 4. So when you calculate this, you get approximately 1751 joules. So let's move to the next one. Compare the rates of emission of heat by a black body maintained at 727 degrees Celsius and at 227 degrees Celsius. Okay, if the black body are surrounded by an enclosure which is at 27 degrees Celsius, what will be their ratio of heat losses? Okay, the situation is like this. There is a black body. Near to this, there is another black body. This is our black body A and this is our black body B, let us say. So this fellow is emitting, he is radiating. Okay. So suppose there is no surrounding, then the amount of energy that is radiated is proportional to the T to the power of 4. That's why we have already seen that Stefan rule. But he is also radiating. So some heat will be absorbed again by this black body. So what is the heat loss? So if this is T0 temperature, this is T temperature. So the heat loss will be given by what is the amount radiated? Sigma T to the power of 4. What is absorbed because of the nearby black body? It is sigma T0 to the power of 4. So our answer will be, so heat loss, if I say delta H1 by delta H2, okay, so it will be sigma T to the power of 4. You have to take this temperature, This is case 1. So 727 plus 273, it is 1000 to the power of 4 minus. Now this body is maintained at 27 degrees Celsius. So it is 300 to the power of 4 divided by sigma multiplied by 2 times 27 means 500 to the power of 4 minus. In the case of another situation, now this temperature is 227, which is 500, but this another black body is maintained at 300 only. I am talking in terms of Kelvin. So sigma sigma cancels. If you calculate this, you get approximately 18.23:1. Okay. Some more questions we will see in the next class.